In this video, we will explain why the resting membrane potential in cells is negative and how it is achieved. Let's first explain what a membrane potential is. A membrane potential exists when there's an imbalance in opposite charges across the membrane. If we look at the situation here where there is no potential, each side of the membrane has 12 positive charges and 12 negative charges, and every positive charge is paired to a negative charge. If we would now separate some of these pairs and place the negative charges on one side of the membrane and the positive charges on the other side of the membrane, then we actually generate a membrane potential. Now we see that there is an imbalance in charges, as there is more negative charges on one side of the membrane and more positive charges on the other side of the membrane. Let's take this to the cell. Each side of the cell membrane has both positive and negative ions. In general, there is a higher concentration of positive sodium and positive calcium on the outside of a cell compared to the inside. Those positive ions are balanced by a high concentration of chloride ions that are negative. Looking on the inside of the cell, there is a higher concentration of potassium ions, and those positive potassium ions are balanced by other anions like negatively charged amino acids, which we depict here by capital letter A. If we consider a cell at rest, the membrane potential in general will be around minus 70 millivolts, meaning that there is more negative ions on the inside of the cell compared to the outside of the cell. A key thing to remember is that only a small number of positive and negative ions need to be separated to create this membrane potential, and also that this difference in charge mainly exists close to the membrane. Let's now see who is responsible for creating the negative resting potential in cells. The first player that helps accomplish the resting membrane potential is the sodium-potassium ATPase pump. As you might recall from lecture, this pump is an example of active transport in which ATP is hydrolyzed to move ions against their concentration gradient. For each ATP molecule that is being hydrolyzed, the pump moves 3 positive sodium ions out of the cell and 2 positive potassium ions into the cell. The result of this pump action is actually twofold. First, as the pump brings more positive ions out of the cell compared to inside the cell, it contributes directly to the negative membrane potential because of the buildup of positive charges on the outside of the cell and negative charges on the inside. The second result of the pump action is very important. It results in creating and supporting the concentration gradient across the membrane for both potassium and sodium. Remember that we just told you that the concentration of potassium is in general higher inside the cell and the concentration of sodium is higher outside the cell? The second player responsible for the rest potential is the potassium leak channel. These leak channels are an example of passive transport in which potassium ions move down their concentration gradient. As our concentration of potassium is higher inside the cell, the ions will flow out of the cell, making the inside less positive compared to the outside. These channels are actually the biggest contributors in creating the negative membrane potential. As the positive potassium ions continue to leave the cell, after a while they will feel attraction from the growing negative charges on the inside of the cell. At this point, there's actually an electrical gradient that is being created. This electrical gradient opposes the chemical concentration gradient that was driving potassium ions out of the cell. A point will be reached where the electrical gradient and the concentration gradient are balanced, and at that point, no further net movement of potassium ions will occur. The amount of charge present on both sides of the membrane when this equilibrium point is reached determines the cell's resting membrane potential.